hybrid modeling for large designs. I'm Scott Christensen. By trade, I'm a tool and diemaker, die designer. Been in the trade way too many years by now. Founded Summer Tool Design in 1991 specifically to do progressive die design in 3D. Starting out with the predecessor to Solid Edge, Graph EMS. In 1996, I added services, training, and consulting for Solid Edge. So for about 20 years, I've been supporting other Solid Edge users in how to use the product, sharing what I learn every day, using it to do progressive die design. I mean, I don't want to scare anybody away that this is a progressive die design class. It's not. I'm working in the context of a progressive die, but what I'm going to show you will apply to many different categories of work and design disciplines. How to quickly build your data for building materials, fill out your title blocks using assembly queries, using the new capabilities of assembly subtract and recognize whole to quickly place many holes, Fastener Systems, parts library, and more. The category of tool and die that I work in is sheet metal stamping dies, and I cover the range of parts. In the upper right, a medical part, 2,000s thick material, barely the size of the tip of a ballpoint pen. Down in the lower right, heavy duty truck components, 20-inch diameter or 4 foot long, front frame of a semi-truck, and then anything in between, automotive, hardware, any category of sheet metal stamping I've designed stamping tooling for. Large transfer dies, progressive dies, small dies, the one on the left, in-die tapper, 440 tap, 632 taps, just a basic stamping on the right. Every now and then somebody asks me to model a cast part or a molded part, a little bit of fixture work, but mostly what I do is sheet metal stamping dies. I do go out and do training, so if you like what you see here today, grab a business card and maybe I can come do some training for you. As I mentioned, I'll be working in the context of a progressive die, but don't think of this as a progressive die workflow. I think you'll be able to take it home and apply it to what you do in many cases. I got a lot to cover, short time to do it, so if you could hold your questions until I'm finished, it'll help me get through what I have to show. Starting out, I want to run through a script layout, and as noted in the title, a hybrid workflow, ordered, synchronous together. All my work starts with some sort of data that I receive from the customer, typically through an IGES or a STEP file, parasolid file, that I need to build into a script layout that is the entire template of where my design is going to go. And stepping through this, in an ordered file using feature playback, you'll see just the process of building this into the strip, patterning, adding tabs of material, unbending, rebending. So that's some of the most important reason I work in ordered for the strip layout, is to be able to use unbend, rebend, change bend angle, so forth. And because we got limited time today, I can't do a deep dive into this, but running through the feature playback will give you a good sense of the process that I go through. And you'll start to see some red patches, red surface patches appear. Those are created with bounded surface, either by part edges or sketches. And those are very integral to the work that I'll be doing in synchronous, creating protrusions or cutouts in other components of the assembly. So that would be as you can see, I've got a synchronous part copy, brought it into the file, positioned it, oriented it, to the tooling. And then the rest of it is all a number of ordered features. And this is a much longer list. It's just grouped together. Of course, there's many ordered features within there. Moving over to the design that I'm going to work in, I have another strip layout. And this one is more synchronous oriented. It really just depends on the nature of the part, what do I need to do to the part to get it set up to design my tool. And as I got further into it, transformed it to sheet metal, then changed some bend angles, and got it configured as needed using the ordered environment. Are there any tool designers, progressive die designers in the room today? Right, good to see you. The first thing I'm going to do in the design is to design a blanking die block using edit in place to do the blanking cuts in this section of the tool. So creating a part in place. I have a variety of templates that I use depending on the part size and what the intent of the block is, and then of course select the material type. And for now, because I don't really know where I want to position this block exactly, and because I'm a couple of levels deep into the assembly, I can't snap to existing locations in the file. So I'm going to turn off Edit in Place, create my file. And it drops in the new component at the assembly origin. And at this point, I can grab it with the synchronous steering wheel and move it around and start snapping to key points as to where I might want to locate it. Or just gives me a sense of a dimension. And in this case, a 6.5-inch value allows me to position that roughly in the center of the work area. I now want to size it to fit the space. So attaching my steering wheel to the end of the block, I'm going to drag it over, key point snap to the end of the adjacent block. And then because I want a gap between the block, I'm going to back it off 50 thousandths. Another method of doing that would be to attach the steering wheel to the face. Using the shift key, I can offset the steering wheel by 50 thousandths, so when I make my key point snap, I get the gap that I'm looking for. I can also use a face relate of offset. Create a face relate. It would be non-persistent, but it would position that to be 50 thousandths offset from the adjacent face. Here I'm using a coplanar face relate to bring both the front and the back to the match the size of the adjacent blocks. And then selecting the top face exposes a dimension, and I can bring it up to the full 2-inch height that I'm using in this design. This is a real design that I did within the last year or so. So this is real work that is now in production. I've done all these changes from the assembly level. I'm not actually in the part yet, but at this point I do want to go in and start modifying the part, edit in place. But before I do that, take a look at the bill of material note, the callout, PMI callout. You'll notice I've got my dimensions. Those came in with my template file. They're actually driving the size of the block, of course, but it's also feeding into the bill of material information I need. Going into file properties and selecting from my predefined Prop C file, I don't have a lot of keying in that I have to do to complete the information that I want to see in the bill of material. Here you can see my dimensions in the file properties, and then pick off the heat treat value that I want for this component. Say okay. Now using an extrude from face, the red surface patches that I pointed out previously, I'm going to use those to cut my my die openings. I've temporarily turned off my design body so they don't get in the way of my selection. With my selection made, I'm going to go into cut mode, which I toggle between add material or cut with the space bar. And I want to go 375 deep, 3/8 deep, to create a straight wall land for the die. I can also use extrude from face, but switching over to single mode, I'm going to pick a couple of edges for these holes off the strip layout as well. So I'm doing a lot of work here that previously we would have had to do with a sketch or project a sketch, include. I haven't created a sketch yet, but I'm well into the design of a die block. At this point, I would need to do an offset for cutting punch and die clearance. I don't have an offset command within the synchronous environment. So I transition to the ordered mode, and I have a offset faces command in chain mode that I'm going to select those cutting edges. And apply just it'll be very hard to see on the screen, a 5/1000ths of an inch offset to the die opening. At this point, I no longer need to maintain that as an ordered feature, so I'm going to move it to synchronous and then transition back to the synchronous environment. These edges on the front and back would be considered heel edges. We don't want the full 5/1000ths cutting clearance, so I'm going to attach the steering wheel and pull them forward, tighten up the clearance a little bit, 3.5/1000ths. It was very easy to get a hold of them with the steering wheel and make the edit. So now I need my die openings to go through the remainder of the block. I'm back to extrude from face. I'm going to select the faces at the bottom of those cuts. And notice, even though I have many other planar faces on this block, the cursor is ignoring them. The first time I select a planar face, it sets a Z depth, and only coplanar faces at that depth are eligible to be selected. Go into the cut mode. But before I finish this cut, the reason I separated this into two steps is I want to add a treatment option of draft. I need to draft that opening so the slugs will drop freely through the die. Before I complete, I need to check the angle of the draft, which you can kind of see here a little bit, and it's actually going the wrong way, so I can toggle that. And notice as I go above the block, I'm adding material. Synchronous senses, are you penetrating or extruding above? As I go below, it automatically goes into cut mode. And with the cut complete, if we go look at the bottom of the block, you can actually see that I've got a draft angle in there now. Moving along to place some screws and dowels for mounting, I have a number of screws, dowel holes, that through hole safe setting I save off, so I don't have to go into the full dialogue. I can just quickly go to a shortcut list and pull them off, tapping off the corner, dimension the hole location, gives me the hole as well as the dimensions driving the location. Before I continue on, I want to increase the depth a little bit, by a quarter of an inch to a full inch deep, so there's some grind life on this block. While the cursor is still attached to that hole, go into the pattern command and define a pattern 3x2. The holes. Placing the dowel holes, again, go to my shortcut list. I know the key letters, so I can scroll through the list quickly. This time tapping off the center of the hole and aligning to it, keying in the dimensional offset. And because this is a 2-inch block, I want to add some clearance on the top. Again, I go into the edit handle, and increase that depth from the default a little bit.
What were the little holes for?
Excuse me?
What were the little holes for?
Our dowels. I also need a hole for a spring lifter pin. It's just going to be a simple straight green hole, so I don't need to go into my list for that. I'm going to tap off the corner and give it dimensional location. And it defaults to the quarter inch size hole that I have set as the default in the software. And then I can just go in and edit the value. It's much quicker to do it that way than trying to open the hole, the entire hole dialog. It takes a couple of seconds to get that dialog to come up. And then I also want a pattern of this feature, this time 2x2. And as I finished out of there, I hit my enter key just a little too quick. I've got a hole that's too close to my cutting edge. That's going to break through. That's a bad die condition is what we would call that. So at this level, I don't have to go back into the pattern to suppress that. I can just select it and delete it. If I go back into the pattern, that hole is still there. It's just in a suppressed state, and I can turn it back on. One thing I want to do before leaving the block would be to recognize holes. I have the two punch holes, punch and pilot holes in the center. And I'm just going to let the software recognize those for what they are. I've already sized them. That way I have hole attributes that I can retrieve when I go to the draft file. I'm now back at the assembly level, sub-assembly level for this component. I want to use the Fastener system, which is dependent on having the solid edge standard library loaded. And I'm going to use the option of all on face, which is going to look at the edges of the hole, and anything that's a common diameter, it's going to automatically select, pick a cylinder to define the length required. And because I don't have a nut or a cap hole or anything I'm going into, it doesn't fully understand what my hole is about, so I have to give it a little more input. Tell it I'm looking for a socket head cap screw. It's going to be a half 13, and I have to tell it what my minimum extension is going to be on the hole. And if you notice, they came in upside down. That's because I picked the bottom face. That's the shoulder of the cap screw. But there's an option to flip those. So just quickly tap the button. Flip them around and they're oriented correctly. Going into standard parts, I want to grab a couple of dowel pins. If you haven't loaded standard parts, I would certainly encourage you to do that. There's tens of thousands of components in there, from bearings and washers and structural cross sections and many things that I can't even think of right now. It's not necessary to load the whole library. I've loaded just the components that are of interest to me. You get much better response out of your library. It's easier to filter through and much less of a footprint on your hard drive. I have a number of dowel pins that I commonly use. They're bookmarked so I can quickly get to the ones I want. Relationships are automatically captured fit as part of the library. Place the dowel pin. And the last component out of the library remains on the Windows clipboard until it is replaced by something else. I can just paste in my second dowel pin. I mentioned earlier that I need a spring lifter pin in here. I've already used it in the adjacent die block, so it's already in my assembly. I can select from here and copy and paste. Or I can also just drag and drop from the Pathfinder. Using flash fit with an edge, finding the edge at the top of the pin, and the edge of the hole gives me a planar align and an axial align, locking the rotation. Going into the lifter, I mentioned it's a spring lifter, but we don't see any spring here. I do have a library of die springs that I've built over the years. that are set up as adjustable components, so I can place them in the design many, many times, but vary it depending on the compression required. A couple of ways I can do that. If you look at the form, I can key in a preload and a travel, so I can store my design intent. What did I actually want that preload and travel to be as I designed the dive? Or I can also measure the spring space using the measuring tools on the dialog. And I will measure from the bottom of the lifter pin to the cap screw, and that creates an assembly variable. And as I close out of here, you'll see the spring resized to match that space. And because a helical feature does not have a true cylinder that I can identify to create an axial relationship to, I'm going to turn on the coordinate system. And then I can find the end of the spring, lead back to the bottom of the pin, switch over to axial align with the lock option, select the leg of the coordinate system, place the spring in place. So wherever that that spring is used, or that lifter pin is used, that spring will now be included. I'm going to take it, pattern it into my block based on the holes that I created. There's my lifter pin with spring, and if it's used elsewhere in the design, that spring will show up there as well. So back to the top level assembly. As the coil stock feeds in from the right off of a big coil of steel from a feeder, I need to have some stock guides to guide and channel the material through the die. So I'm going to create a stock guide. Create in place. I'm going to select a different part. This one is just a small die part. This is a smaller component than what I worked on before, so I just size my template accordingly, set material type. I do know an offset from assembly origin that I want, so I'm going to key in the value. Creates my component. Back to my bill of material information again. I'm going to do some bill of material work later on, so I want to make sure I have my bill of material information set up. Go down my guide or my POPC file list. Key in the appropriate document number. Select the heat treat from the list. And that's all the bill of material work that I need to do for this particular part. With that complete, I'm going to start dragging the component to size. I don't know exactly what I want for size at this point. I'm just going to roughly drag it to its position. On this front face, I know that I want it to overhang the edge of the coil about a quarter of an inch. So I'm going to attach my steering wheel, offset it by a quarter. Key point snap. Drag this to the end of the block. One shortcut that you might want to be aware of is Control Shift D. Temporarily suspends the dynamic of the edit. This kind of clears up the view for me. This might snap it a little bit, so bring that back. To finish out the size, I'm going to edit the dimension value that was brought in from my template. Using the extrude from face, I want to cut the channel, a lip, in the stock guide, so I'm going to select the edge strip layout. It's in add mode. I want to toggle it with my space bar to cut mode. and I've cut a little a lip in the in my stock guide. I need to lift that a quarter of an inch on that spring-loaded pin, plus some clearance. So I'm going to raise that up 300 thousandths. So that gives me a guide rail running right on the back edge of the strip as my clearance to lift the material a quarter of an inch, plus 50 thousandths of running clearance. And add some holes to drop it in place. Now this time I'm just going to grab a 5/16 counter bore, drop it on the face, not tapping off the edge, giving it any dimensions. I want to align to an existing hole in another component. Before I do that, I'm going to just edit the depth of the counter bore, and then using the steering wheel to just align it to the mating hole. Create a pattern of that. It's time to pattern of 5x1. Add the remaining holes. Place the dowel pin hole. Again, go to my shortcut list. Predefined holes. Snap to the center of the hole and offset the value. To enable that snap capability, you do need to have your F3 plane lock enabled. Without that, you cannot ID the hole and snap to it. Dowel pin holes. And to finish out the component, I want to add a chamfer, unequal setbacks, a couple of different options there, angle and setback, select the face, select the edges that I want the chamfer to apply to, and key in the values. That's my diagram. Back to the assembly level for this component. Using the fastener system again. This time I'm going to select the shoulder of the counter bore and the tapped hole for the cylinder. And with that additional selection effort, it's narrowed my list. It knows that it's in a counter bore hole, so I'm probably going to want a socket head cap screw. The tapped hole defines it as a 5/16 18 thread, so it doesn't give me the other options that you saw in the previous use of fastener system. When I select this, it also has already calculated my 1.5 times diameter engagement, so I'm good to go. And I could have selected the other four holes to include in that fastener system, but sometimes it's more efficient to just place the one occurrence of it and then pattern it to the remaining locations. So either way works just as well. Just what amount of mouse clicking do you want to do? At this point, I want to mirror this stock guide around to the front side. I need virtually the same copy of it for the front side, right? The front side coil. So to do that, I'm going to do a little setup work and create a reference plane, parallel offset reference plane, so I can have some running clearance on the front side guide rail. Go into the mirror components, select the assembly to mirror, select the plane that I want to mirror about. I just got several planes sitting in the same location. I want to use Quick Pick to make sure I get that parallel offset. And it brings up my dialog for defining the parameters of this mirror operation. First thing I want to do is assign a name. I could take the system assigned name, but I want to name it to my existing my standard. Folder where it's coming. and go. The stock shelf that's highlighted at the end of the guides, I don't want to include that in the mirror, so I'm going to exclude that. This is the actual component that is going to be mirrored. Again, I want to assign the name. I don't want the system to assign the name. And I'm also going to select a specific template that I want to use for this mirror operation, and we'll come back to that in just a minute as to why I did that. And then that leaves my screws, and the system is seeing those as a component that needs to be mirrored, but those are out of my standard parts library. I don't want to keep replicating those through my system, so I'm just going to set those to rotate instead of mirror and copy. And then I need to define which reference plane those are going to go around. You can see that they're sticking out of the hole in the wrong direction. So by resetting the plane, they're in the hole in the correct orientation. So that defines my my mirror operation. Close and return. Click finish. And I've got my guide rail. But as I noted, I wanted to make some modification to this. So I'm going to go in and make an edit to this guide rail. And when we get in there, we'll see that I'm back in order. It's a little bit of a hybrid workflow. This is a part copy, so it's in the ordered environment. If we look at my bill of material information, it's copied part of it. It's got my name, it's got the material type, it's got the heat treat, but it doesn't have the dimension values. So before I proceed, I want to add some dimensions. And you'll note that these are a different color than in synchronous, a kind of a magenta color. They're not driving the part. These are driven dimensions. The part size is controlling what their values will be. But with those dimensions placed, I can go into my variable table, and this is why I selected a specific template to do my mirror operation. I'm going to select these values to feed into my bill of material. So I've already done a little setup work in my template to push those through to the bill of material. I update that little reminder note that I have, you'll see my dimensions are in place. The edit that I want to make to the file, to make it easier to feed the coil stock into the channel, I like to shorten the front end of that a little bit. So I'm going to fence select the end, pick up the hole, pick up the end of the guide, and using an ordered move faces command. And I'm just, because the coordinate system is a fixed, permanent feature within the file, I'm going to use that as my edge to move along. Snap to the hole for my from point. And then find the existing hole in a mating component. And move the end of the part. As I finish out of here, closing and returning to the assembly, you notice that my screw did not move with it. And if we think through that a minute, that makes sense, because that screw is a mirror copy of this one. It's controlled by that parent feature. So I want to back up a little bit, go into the mirror copy, and find that particular screw and exclude it from the mirror operation. For some reason I ended up with multiple copies of my mirror here. Try it one more time. There we go. And now I need to have a screw in that hole. This is a place where I can just use a Control C for window copy, Control V for placing a new screw in that hole. I also note that on my initial placement, I missed the dowel pins. I missed the dowel pins in my first assembly, so I'm going to go back into my standard parts, again my bookmark dowel pins that I commonly use many times in a day. Relationships are captured as part of the delivered library. Component remains on the clipboard. Place in a second copy. As I close out of here, you'll notice that those dowel pins have appeared in my front copy. They're part of the assembly. They mirror with the assembly. I'm at the top level of the assembly. I note that there was a couple of chamfers that I wanted to include on the parent part. This is a synchronous part, so I can add these from the assembly level. And it can do it for the ordered as well. But as I finish out of there, because I have an associative part copy, they're appearing on the front side as well. Next operation I need to do is to go into the die block that they're sitting on top of and add the holes, screw and dowel holes. Going back to a face select, making sure that I set my option to be use internal only, select the top faces of those stock guides, just drag down, cut some holes, creates just simple cylinders within the block. I want to select the two faces, go to my recognize hole command, and it finds two sets of holes. Four holes will be the dowel pins, eight holes will be for the tab. I don't want to recognize the dowels at this point. We'll address those in just a moment. The path holes go to my shortcut list. Select the appropriate safe settings of holes, and it now has converted those simple cylinders into a 5/16 18 capped hole. The reason I delayed identifying the dowel pins is I want those to come from the bottom side with a counter grilled relief. So breaking it into two operations, I'm changing the penetration surface for that hole. So it gives me a counter drilled hole from the bottom side. And by splitting the operation into two steps, I'm controlling what surface I'm penetrating from. Screws and dowels for the guide pins. I also have a number of holes that need to be placed for the die blocks that sit on top of the die shoe. I've got a few holes in there already, but I don't have the screws and dowels that mount the die blocks to the shoe. So I want to get to, I want to be able to select all the screws as input into the assembly subtract command. An easy way to do that is using your assembly query. And I'm going to query for fasteners. All my fasteners that I use out of the standard parts library have had a material assigned a fastener. So I'm going to query for that. I'm going to select the scope of the query to be parts currently shown. Run the query. And holding down my control key, I'm also going to include the plate in the selection and do a show on it. I've got all the screws that I want, plus some that I don't want. So by picking just a few of the representative sizes that I know that I don't want, and then a shortcut customization that I've set up of alternate A, I can deselect, hide those screws that I don't want. Now, how many are using ST7 or 8 still? Okay, quite a few of you. There's been some new capability added into ST9 for recognizing holes that you won't have on the earlier version of the software. So I'm going to run subtract on this this plate twice. Once to show you how to address this in ST8 and earlier, and then we'll take a look at what the ST9 will do for us. So going into subtract command, I'm going to turn off recognize holes. That's not part of ST6, 7, or 8. I'm going to select the plate as my target, and then this small grouping of fasteners on the end, I'm going to fence select and subtract those from the plate. Moving along, I'm going to go back to recognize holes. And if you were in Art's session earlier today, he commented on this, that ST9 subtract will recognize threaded holes and any pins or shafts that penetrate a plate. It will create a hole and offset it to the next nominal size larger. Because my screws do not penetrate all the way through, as Art noted, there can be some situations that recognize hole doesn't handle. It can only do what the recognize hole command is capable of. So I'm going to turn those options off. But if your fastener goes all the way through a plate, it will create a tap hole for you. And then do another fence select. And you'll notice I've got screws that aren't entering the plate. Some are hanging off the end. Those aren't going to create any harm. Select my target plate, then select the group that I want. And for those of you that have been using the software for a while, know that the effort that it took to place holes like this not all that long ago. Many, many mouse clicks to get all these holes placed. Going into the plate, you can see I have a number of holes on the end. These are just simple cylinders. The cone chamfer on the bottom. Those that I used on the ST9 option are actually holes. Now the problem that you can run into with ST8 and earlier is the chamfer on the bottom of the hole can cause recognized hole to not fully understand what to do with it. And a quick way to address that is to recognize chamfers. And you can see it's come up with a list of 6 to 8, 10 chamfers. And those are the chamfers in the bottom of these holes. When it finishes processing, there are features at the bottom of the list, which I can just quickly select and delete. Selecting the two faces, I want to recognize hole. And I've got 4 holes, which I know are dowel pins, and another 6 holes, which I know are tap. But if you don't always recall what those might be, you can turn on your display of your assembly in the background to help clue you in. Select the appropriate hole type from my predefined list, and I turn those into a press fit dowel pin hole and half 13 tap holes. Escape key a little too quick, so I'm going to run the command again. We're running out of time here, so I'm going to get to the right. trying to get everything in here, and I hit the escape key before the command is completely finished, so it can't quite finish, but there we go. Path 13 tapped. Select this hole. Half inch press fit hole drilled and counter bored for a press fit half inch dowel. So those are now correct. Over here we've got, and if we scroll down the list a little bit, here's my subtract operation. The holes that it created with that, three different holes, and then I've got two at the bottom that I ran recognize on to find those. I want to come in and finish out what these holes are here. They are holes, but it doesn't know that because I had thread recognition turned off, it doesn't know that I want this to be a half inch 13 line tapped hole. Create a tapped hole. Go to the second grouping. And I can tell just by this diameter, knowing what the diameter of the dowel pin is, but that would be a press fit for a dowel pin. Select that. Processes, drills it through, sizes it for a press fit dowel. One last set of holes to find. And that's a half inch, and it's going to be a also a half 13 tap. And you'll say, well, why didn't it find that with the previous group? There's a slight difference in the extension of the screw, so the hole is a little bit different. So it sees that depth as being a different hole. If I had those screws set at the exact same penetration depth, we'd be good. So I just come in and recognize hole on that as well. It's not really a big deal, but that might be why you're seeing different groupings of the same, what would typically be the same hole. One more thing that I want to do before I leave this plate. I need to have, this plate will be purchased as a burnout, torch cut burnout, for the slug drops to come through the bottom of the shoe. I'm going to use an inner part copy to grab the bottom face off the die block that I created. And the reason I want to do that is I need to do a 3/16, maybe a quarter inch offset on that burnout. And as you know, sometimes when you project a sketch with an offset, or you try to offset faces with the offset faces command, small radiuses and intersections can start causing you trouble. So this is a different way to approach that problem, just adding another tool into your toolbox. Using the bounded surface command, I'm going to fill in one of those faces. Typically I would do all four, but we don't have the time today to do that. And then using the extend surface edge command, I'm going to fence select, find all those edges, and then I have much more capability to extend those edges. I don't run into as much trouble as what I do sometimes with project a sketch. Not saying that project a sketch is bad, this is just another tool to add to your toolbox. And then I can extrude from face, create the hole, we're good to go.
You said that was bounded edge?
A bounded surface.
Oh, bounded.
So now we're back at the assembly level, it's time to head into draft. A couple of things that I do before I go to draft is to create some display configurations. And again, using the built-in capability of the configuration.txt file, you can have if you use common names, common configuration names, you can have those built into the software for you, so you don't have to do a lot of keying in. I'm just going to create a couple here real quickly, just to give an example of what I would typically do. I'm sure most of you have created configurations. One that is very helpful with setting up the bill of material is to go back to my assembly query. Again, I'm going to look for material type of fastener. The scope of my search is going to be the entire design file at this point. Running the query, I want to hide those. And we'll see why in just a moment. But in doing that, that's not what I wanted to do. I actually hit show only when I wanted to hit hide. So we'll run the query again. It's still set to go. This time make sure that I hit hide. And then I create a configuration of that. But before I do, I have one other query that I want to run. A lot of my customers, they don't want to see the commodity hardware of screws and dowels. They just go and pull them out of their cabinet. They don't want them in the bill of material. But a shoulder screw has a little bit more function to it, so I'm going to change my query type to title. And I find that I have one socket head shoulder screw that I do want to include that into my bill of material. I'm going to create a new display configuration of full assembly without fasteners. And then I've got one that opens up the die to expose the internal components. It's going to take me into Explode, Render, and Animate. And I just want to make sure that before I go to graph, this is up to date with any new components that I've created. And remember that you can use your configuration manager to do things like that, of including or excluding things from your configuration. Save it. Return to the assembly, and now I'm ready to go into create drawing, select the appropriate template.
Scott, while you're doing that, 11 o'clock is break, so you can keep going. There's all people want to start.
Sounds good.
I don't know, we have a couple minutes left. So.
And before I drop this on the graph sheet, I'm going to go into the drawing view wizard, select my open die view, got just a couple minutes to go here, drops the view on the sheet. For those of you that are familiar with die design, you'll notice that I've got some stripper plates here that are hiding a number of components under the under those stripper plates. I want to go into display properties. And if you have a large assembly and you've been working on it for a couple of weeks, you might forget what files are named, where they're located. Remember that you have the highlight selection capability that you can use to drill down through your assembly and know what you're looking for. I want to set these particular components to display as reference. You can see that it's already started to change the symbology of the view, update the view, and you can see I now am looking at all the components under the assembly. Takes me over to creating a parts list, identify the view, make sure my ballooning is turned on, go into display properties. I have a number of different formats that I use, so I'm selecting the one that I want to run for this today. Going into list control, and this is where the configuration full assembly without fasteners is helping me. As soon as I pick this, you'll notice that all the fasteners have gone to unselected, unhighlighted. It's excluding those from the bill of material. Click to finish the list. I have no fasteners in my bill of material other than the single shoulder screw that I selected. My view is nicely ballooned. But I do have customers that will say, how many fasteners of a certain size, or what are the fasteners within this assembly? I can easily generate that for them with a different configuration. I can select another parts list, make sure I turn off link to active, select the view. I don't want to add any balloons to the drawing. Go back into the, selecting the list, go to a different format. Go to list control. This time I want to select the configuration of fastener hardware. And it drops on a nice short little list of all the fasteners only that are in the design. And one last thing that I have to quickly show. Using the ST9 tabs at the top, I want to create a drawing. Right click on the part, go to drawing, select the appropriate template. And what I want to show here is just that the bill of material information that I was working to get into these files, but had to spend very little effort doing it. As soon as I click to drop the view, it fully populates that title block for me. And of course, all that information is included in the bill of material. So that wraps up my presentation. Are there any questions?
Yeah, are you using the standard bill of material that comes with solid edge? Or is that an add-on?
No, it is standard bill of material functionality, but formatted to what my customers or I need. There is no. What you saw today is solid edge out of the box.
Okay.
Anything else?
Amazing.